Hank came to our campus in the fall of 1999, a very, very short 12 years ago. We understand he was born, raised, educated, and worked in the Northeast before he came to us. But as you can tell from the outpouring here today, he was quickly adopted as a proud Oregonian and embraced as a vital member of the Western Oregon University community, a community that has struggled this week with our sadness and loss, both professionally and personally. We are honored to have with us today many members of Hank's family, his wife Linda, Lisa, and Alex, his sister Mary Beth, and his mother Mathilde. His father, Henry A. Bersani Sr., was unable to travel from Syracuse, but we are recording today's celebration for him and other members of Hank's extended family. Hank was not only a loving husband, father, son, and brother, he was also, to so many in this room, a colleague, a teacher, a mentor, and a friend. I want to extend our gratitude to Linda and the Bersani family for allowing us the opportunity to share with you and with each other our memories of the man we grew to know and respect over the last decade. Universities are interesting places. I grew up with many people when many people made quilts, not for fashion, usually, but for function. And sometimes I have this image of a university as a big, crazy quilt, full of disparate elements that may seem to have no relationship to one another other than their geographic proximity. The patterns can clash, the colors don't always blend, and the seams holding everything together are right out there in the open. But those quilts, as my grandmother knew, were the ones you went to when you wanted something done, when you needed something that would hold up when it was tested, when you wanted something that you could count on, when you needed comfort. And I just can't help but see Hank Bersani right there in the middle of this visual cacophony, smiling that big, broad smile. His wonderfully patterned, brightly colored piece of the Western quilt will always be an important part of the fabric of this university. John Dewey, considered by many to be an iconic figure in progressive education, said, "Education is not preparation for life. Education is life itself." Hank lived that thought in and out of the classroom through his exemplary work and service at Western and around the world. In recognizing such accomplishments by a member of our profession, a university has the prerogative to bestow certain honors. It is not done often nor lightly. Emeritus status is the highest recognition a university can give a professor. It represents the individual's achievement as a professional educator, a scholar, and a colleague. It affirms the impact that they have made on their specific institution. It acknowledges their contributions to the broader field of higher education. On behalf of President Mark Weiss and the faculty and staff of Western Oregon University, I am honored to award emeritus status to Dr. Henry A. Hank Bersani, Professor of Special Education at Western Oregon University. So I end today with a quote from Henry Adams that seems particularly appropriate at this time and in this place. Adams said, "A teacher affects eternity. He can never tell where his influence stops."
Good afternoon. My name is Hilda Rosselli, and I have the honor of serving as the Dean of the College of Education here at Western Oregon University. When I first met Hank Bersani, I was actually interviewing with the search committee for the dean's position here at Western Oregon 10 years ago. And Hank was on the search committee. And as you can imagine, he peppered me with some good questions, some of which I didn't have answers for. Like many others have shared, he and Linda were so hospitable in welcoming us to Oregon and, of course, When two Italians get together, the conversation soon turned to the best cannoli, our favorite recipes, and how to get good mozzarella on the West Coast. Hank served as the division chair for the special education division in the college and was reappointed in 2007. So as you can imagine, we interacted a lot. This week, when I looked back, I found over 2,900 emails that we exchanged over the past 10 years. And those emails were about all sorts of things: course schedules, budgeting, personnel matters, curriculum needs, policies, student issues, required reports, promotion and review processes, chair meetings, consortiums, strategic planning, and yes, dreaming. As you can imagine, he was never shy in sharing his opinions on all of these matters. And there were times when we saw things differently. But to his credit, when he raised an issue, he worked hard to propose solutions. And that is an invaluable gift. Although I see the act of serving as division chair as one of the ultimate forms of service in a university, Hank's service spanned far beyond Western Oregon University. And in my opinion, one of the most lasting legacies that he made was in helping to change the name of one of the oldest and well-known professional associations in his discipline. When he first joined this association, it was known as the American Association on Mental Deficiency. While he was a member, it changed to the American Association on Mental Retardation. But by the time he gave his speech as president of the association, he had helped to change the name to the American Association on Intellectual and Developmental Disabilities. It was these types of advocacy efforts that helped ensure dignity and respect for the individuals for which that association dedicates its efforts. During my review of emails, I also found dozens of messages from Hank, always letting me know when he would be away from campus at professional meetings all over the world. But he always was concerned about sharing that he had made provisions to cover his classes. Hank's knowledgeable and engaging presentation style was widely sought after, not only in this country, but in Argentina, Iceland, Australia, Sweden, South Africa, Nova Scotia, Norway, Sweden, Ireland, Canada, and Doha, Qatar. I was always so impressed how he made a special effort to deliver part of his presentations in the native tongue. We'd have fun sometimes in the hallway when he was practicing what he was going to say. And he was particularly excited about a repeat invitation from the Queen of Qatar to participate this fall in an international forum, again, focused on the issue of disability, this time focused on how it impacts individuals who have been in a nation suffering from conflict. I know he would have made such a contribution there. I also had the opportunity to co-teach a special education class with Hank, and I had the chance to witness firsthand his impact on students. His boisterous style and his acerbic wit were sometimes overwhelming at first to students. But over time, he had a way of helping students see things in a different light through the use of great stories, personal experiences, and humor. Although I'm sure we always thought of Hank as a confident teacher, I found one email from November 2010 in which I had shared with him that I'd been lucky enough to walk by his classroom 3 days in a row and just wanted to share with him how lucky our students were to have him as their teacher, given the knowledge and experience he had to share. He wrote back thanking me and then commented, "Teaching week after week can fill one with self-doubt." Today, as we remember Hank, the teacher, you'll hear firsthand from some of his students whose recollections symbolize so many students' memories. We hope today to also honor some of the other facets of Hank's life beyond that of teacher and scholar. and to thank him properly for what he shared with us, both personally and professionally, during his time at Western Oregon University. And I can think of no one better to start this off than his longtime colleagues, Mickey Pardue and Meredith Brodsky, who will be sharing next.
Hank and I used to joke that we don't need microphones, so I've shared the Mimi will have the mic. I'm Mickey Pardue, and I just wanted to start by saying for Hank, colleagues are literally defined by all faculty and staff of Western. He made no distinction in his connection across the entire campus. We're all his colleagues, many of whom are represented today. Meredith, who we, close to her, call her Mimi, so if I switch back and forth, it's the same person, was serving as the Dean of the College of Ed when Hank was hired, and I was a faculty member. We hope in our time today to capture your experiences as we relate ours. We also want to thank Linda, Lisa, and Alex for sharing Hank with us over many years. You were very generous.
Thanks, Mickey. My time of knowing Hank goes back to the 1980s. At that time, I was a fairly young professional, but Hank was already a rock star in the field of special education. He spoke at national conferences with a compelling and very important message about the rights of children and adults with severe disabilities to live more normal and better lives outside of institutions. As president of the Oregon chapter of the Association of Severe Handicaps, I invited Hank to be the keynote speaker at our first statewide conference in Oregon. He was, as usual, a big hit. We couldn't pay him very much, but I bought him a gift certificate to Powell's and a box of Euphoria chocolates from Eugene. And he later told me that those two things were compelling enough to bring him back to Oregon.
I assisted in this conference event and met Hank for the first time. The conference planners and Hank joined for dinner at Jake's in Portland that evening. He asked us about what kind of bookstore this Powell's was, and we started raving about it being the best bookstore ever. His sarcasm and skepticism snuck in, and he agreed to check it out after dinner. Well, the next morning he shared that he closed down the place. And he joined in our assessment of the label of best, because Hank was always a first-hand researcher in all phases of life. He would later say that Powell's and Roberto's ice cream influenced his decision to move to Oregon. We were excited to sow the seeds of his migration, but I know that family members in BC, Canada also played a part.
During those early years, Hank and I did not work in the same organization, and we often competed with each other for grants. But we always were far more colleagues than competitors, with common advocacy goals to improve the lives of people with disabilities by pushing the Oregon legislature, state agencies, and community organizations for more funding, greater understanding, and better services. Many of us, and many of us who are here today, Jana and Holly, pushed for change, and Hank was often the front charger of the advocates, always a forceful and energetic voice for better services and better lives. Hank is clearly an intellectual person, but for him it was not just an intellectual or even a political battle. For Hank, it was always much more personal. He always had friends, close friends, who had severe disabilities. He and Linda have very generously and over many, many years given time, resources, love, and support to these friends. I remember when Hank helped his friend David Beam run for office in Salem. I remember that I had a lawn sign and that David lost, but got more votes than I would have ever guessed. And that election process itself changed perceptions. With Hank's guidance, David became a strong, vocal, and effective advocate for himself and others who had grown up in institutions and now wanted to live, work, and contribute in their communities. This is just one of many stories about Hank, his big heart, and his passion.
I followed Hank's career with ARC and OHSU, and we met up from time to time. When our colleague Beverly Herzog retired in 1999, I chaired the committee to find our next professor. Hank called me up and asked if he could apply. He said he was ready to come to Western this time. He had turned down a previous offer in 1981. He wanted an opportunity to come back and train teachers again. As you can imagine, the interview job offer process was very quick. We opened the door and he came in running. He quickly joined the special education faculty, the Bob and Mickey team, and worked with many colleagues. Kim and Marianne are here today, and all the rest of our College of Ed colleagues over the past 13 years. He was also a friend to us, and particularly to my family and my son. Some key adjectives that come to mind to describe Hank as a colleague include inclusive. He was inclusive of all members of the Western family. He made no distinction. We are all his colleagues. He was demanding of dedication, honesty, and collegiality. He was accepting, friendly, humble. Yes, really. He really was humble. He was wise, and he was stubborn. On some occasions, Hank would disagree with the decision that our program selected. He insisted that a better decision should have been made. Invariably, I would return to him weeks or months later and say, "Oh, Hank, you were so right. Why didn't I listen to you?" And he would smile and nod and remind me of his right choice. He was smart. He was funny. We both share, like many here, an East Coast upbringing, so I understood his regional brand of humor and attitude. He was patient and he was honest with the team process, and yet impatient when others slowed down the momentum towards progress and change. Hank expected honesty in return from all his colleagues. And he was real. He embodied the term walk the talk. Only Hank's brand took it from a walk to a sprint.
You can imagine my utter delight when my friend and colleague told me he wanted to be a special education professor at Western. What a perfect place for him to continue his research, writing, and leadership, and also impact future teachers and professionals. His teaching was not just about making a difference with knowledge, but about making a difference with the heart. And that is a light that will last for generations.
Over the past week, I've been searching for a symbol to capture all the facets of Hank. A diamond in the rough came to mind, but in talking about this with another College of Ed colleague, Karen Johnson, she offered the image of a disco ball that spins with many, many facets of mirrors. I'm going to invite you to take a moment to look at the ceiling. I want you to look at it now and see a symbol of our light, our Hank, who will always be with us in the many facets of our memory and our life. Share some of these with each other today before you leave. You are surrounded by students and alumni who can tell you the real stories of Hank. They are the ambassadors of his heart and his light, reaching children and individuals everywhere.
I first came to Western Oregon in the summer of 2002, and at that time, I believe, Hank might have been the division chair. And The first class I had with him was managing communication systems. And Hank was passionate about giving people a voice. And so when I had my first teaching job at Monmouth Elementary School, I had a beautiful young student come into my room who was bright but wasn't able to speak in the traditional way. And the spasticity that she had didn't allow her to even touch her communication board. And so we were trying to find a way to give her a voice. And so I thought, well, I don't know what I'm going to do. I'm going to come talk to Hank. He'll know what to do. And so he graciously agreed to meet with me. And the first thing he said was, so what assessments have you done? I knew he was going to ask me that. And first thing I thought, well, the communication matrix. And he said, exactly. See, you already know what to do. And that's what Hank did. He taught you how to be a problem solver. He wanted you to know that you could do it and that you were part of the solution. And there wasn't anything you couldn't do if you worked together to find a common solution. He wanted you to get outside of your way of thinking and step into someone else's shoes and see the situations they were going to face so that you could be part of the solution. And he was amazing. Thanks to Hank and several other people, that student later on has a Dynavox IMAX, and she's able to access her communication system just by her eye gaze. And he had her back to speak in his class last year and introduce his students so that they too could become part of solving the problem. And last night I saw that student at our prom. Each year Dallas High School's Shanna Laviere has a special ed prom, and she invites the Central High School special ed students, and it is the single biggest night of our year. And she was there dancing away, and Shanna and I were talking about Hank, and she said, you know, Hank is part of the reason this prom exists. And I said, it was Hank's idea to start a special ed prom, and she said, no, but Hank taught me to think outside the box. He taught me that the only limitations we place on these kids are the limitations we place on them, that there weren't any limitations. And that's why I teach the way I do. I thought, wow, what a legacy. He taught people that there weren't any limitations except the limitations we place. And he taught us to think outside the box, and he taught us that we could be part of the solution. So I take that with me every day. And every day I go to work, I think, okay, how do I think outside the box? How do I create solutions? And I'm inspired by him. So I thank you so much.
Our professor Hank was one of the few people I've encountered that could completely offend you and then make you laugh in the same sentence. Some of the things that escaped Hank's mouth made you stumble back at times, which is exactly what he wanted. Like a kid pushing buttons just to see what they would do, Hank had a whole switchboard full and was a master of pushing just the right ones. More so than just a master button pusher, Hank was a great teacher. In the classroom, Hank shared his passion of research, APA style, and instilled in us to continuously ask questions. He had a keen ability to argue both sides and was a great devil's advocate on many issues. To echo a characteristic Hank's son Alex shared about his father this past Thursday, if Hank had to play the role of the bad guy to get you to think more, that was a role he would gladly take on. As for APA style, I doubt any student of Hank can hear it said without thinking of him. And after what seems to be countless literature reviews later, I'm confident that my classmates and I know the difference between gathering research and actually doing research for a paper, and for that matter, what even qualifies as research. Hank was also a great storyteller. One of the first and most impactful things Hank shared with our class was embedded in the story of how he came to special education. Although the details are a little foggy, his daughter Lisa reminded me at his service that he went to serve at a camp for kids with special needs run by Catholic nuns. In his version, Hank maintains that his real motivation for going to the camp was chasing the pretty girls that were serving as well. But in his interview to serve at the camp, one of the nuns asked him a profound question that will stay with me always. Why are you good enough to teach my kids? Her kids being children with severe developmental disabilities. This question had a large impact on Hank, as it does to every person Hank passes it on to. Other stories Hank would tell were often of his family, of his kids' experiences growing up, going to parent-teacher conferences and having Linda kick him under the table as Hank attempted to push the buttons of the regular ed teacher, and of his recent Christmas present from his parents that included a toothbrush case claiming to, as Hank put it, eliminate poop particles from the toothbrush. Then, aside from stories, there were just some of the random, shocking, and inappropriate things Hank would say. And for your sake and mine, I will not be repeating them. No one could say things quite like Hank. As I stated earlier, Hank was always poking and prodding us to ask questions, to question research, to question the popular way of thinking, and to question ourselves. With Hank's departure so soon and sudden, he has left us asking even more questions. I am reassured in knowing that Hank will live on in the life of those he has inspired and taught, which does not only include those students he has taught at Western Oregon University. Hank's breadth of teaching reached far and forgotten corners of the earth. He was and still is a teacher of special education, a teacher of compassion, a teacher whose actions spoke louder than his words, which is hard for Hank, and a teacher of life. Hank lives on in the minds, in the hearts, and in the life's work of all the special educators and people that he has impacted along the way. We will miss you, Hank.
I only knew Hank for a year, and my cohort only had him for two or three classes. But for the last 3 months, we spent 6 hours a week with him. And this may not seem like very much time to anyone here. And to be honest, it's not. It wasn't nearly enough time to spend with a man like Hank. However, it was adequate time for him to make an impression on every person in my cohort. And I believe that the impact Hank's passing has had on people who knew him for such a short period of time is a testament to his character and to the type of person he was. Not everybody liked Hank, and maybe that sounds like a negative quality for someone to have, but personally, I think it's one of the things that made him so brilliant. He had a strong personality which was expressed in everything that he did. I've gone to school for 18 years, and I can honestly say that Hank was my favorite teacher. Of course, I never told him that because I'd probably get some smart-ass comment back. Hank was sarcastic. He was hilarious and dedicated and intelligent. He had an opinion and he would share it with you. Hank had a sense of humor and he would share that with you. And Hank had a passion for teaching and he shared this with every student that was lucky enough to have him as a professor. My cohort has described Hank in many ways. One fellow student expressed that his compassion and love for individuals with disabilities was apparent every time he told a story. Another appreciated that when class discussions would become too heavy, Hank could always lighten the mood with a joke. One individual even compared him to an angel on earth, which I think Hank would get a kick out of. And I know that no one in my cohort will ever forget Hank's valuable advice when it comes to bodily fluids in the classroom. If it's wet and not yours, don't touch it. It's a good rule. I can't describe the impact that Hank has had on my life and the lives of the students he has taught. There's no way to quantify the knowledge, humor, and passion this man has shared. And it's impossible to express the loss that the special education community, Western Oregon University, and future educators experience and will experience now that Hank is no longer with us. However, what is certain is that he will never truly be gone from our minds or hearts. And I know that years from now, there will still be conversations among his past students that start with, "Remember that thing that Hank said?" And quite possibly these conversations will include tears, but they will most assuredly end with laughter. And I think I speak for every student he's ever had when I say, "I miss you, Hank, and I feel blessed to have known you."
You probably know the saying, if you love what you do, you never have to go to work. And boy, this was exactly how Hank viewed research. Though Hank was remarkably erudite, a scholar of international repute, whose counsel was often sought in legal matters relating to disability, research was not work in Hank's eyes, nor was it about moving ahead in the academy. It was absolutely about his love for others and pursuit of social justice. Surely influenced by his incredible mother, Mathilde, the first female judge in New York, he could not tolerate injustice, especially injustice and prejudice as it affects individuals with disabilities. Hank's contributions as a scholar in the field of disabilities had three overarching goals. And if you're trying to remember these later on, they all begin with A. A for action. Firstly, advocacy, creating change for a better world for people with disabilities. And self-advocacy, supporting individuals with disabilities to be able to speak up for their rights, their needs, and dreams. A unique research project that Hank co-designed was to create a self-advocacy vocabulary. This involved surveying multiple individuals with disabilities for vocabulary they felt was most important relating to housing, transportation, employment, personal assistance, and health. To create an essential self-advocacy vocabulary for people with little or no speech, that could be programmed into their speech generation devices or written on communication boards. A second thread of Hank's scholarship was access, ensuring that people with disabilities had tools in place to support their communication, mobility, education, and independence through a combination of augmentative and alternative communication, such as voice generation devices, communication books, and so forth, and assistive technology. And lastly, his research was a battle against ableism, prejudice on the part of able-bodied, able-minded people toward people with disabilities. It's been exhilarating to be involved with all of these aspects of Hank's research over the years. I first met Hank over 17 years ago, a few months after my move from the UK the United States. The honeymoon period of my migration had definitely worn off. I was already doing some volunteer work at the Child Development and Rehabilitation Center at OHSU when Hank bounded in and enlisted me, as I'm sure he's enlisted many of you at some time or other, right? Yes, Mary Beth, you cannot argue with the man, can you? Without making too long a story of this, I was soon working on a huge federally funded grant of which Hank was a co-principal investigator. The grant was designed to research how to train partners in communication working with individuals with little or no speech. And I'm very pleased today that Jan Staley's here too. She worked on that grant with us. The little vignette that I'm about to share exemplifies the research, what research meant to Hank. Hank and I would go out to group homes, the Ark of Oregon, United Cerebral Palsy, and many other places. When if you walked into the room, you could tell Hank was adored. People would run or wheel over to greet him. Hank was like a magnet pulling people together. One of several people I worked with under Hank's supervision was Bob. Bob was a gentleman in his late 50s with CP, and I was to work with him and two assistants to develop a communication book so Bob could better communicate, tell stories, and be independent on bus rides to and from work. During my second visit with Bob and his assistants at UCP, where I would use my own communication book and speech, I knew I wasn't making too much progress. And I said, "Bob, can you hear me?" And one of his assistants said, "Oh no, dear, Bob's deaf." Bob did not communicate using ASL, as his motor impairments meant that he could not make clear signs, so that's why he had needed a communication book. When I saw Hank the next day, I said, "Hey, how come you didn't tell me that Bob's deaf?" You should have seen the wicked grin on Hank's face. As he split his sides laughing, I fumed, "Honestly, Hank." I felt lost for words, so ignorant and helpless. And with a big hug, he said, "And now you know a little of what Bob feels." The Bob story has several other chapters, but this little snapshot illustrates the heart and humanity of Hank's scholarship. Its purpose has always been for teaching and learning, changing minds, building relationships, and creating a better future for people with disabilities, and let's face it, a better future for us all, since we're all likely to experience disability at some point in our lives. To Hank's much beloved and inspirational family, we thank you for sharing this great man with us and with the world.
So to celebrate Hank's cycling life is really only fitting, since one way he celebrated life was on the bike. Though difficult to capture in just a few minutes, his love affair with cycling, it's still noteworthy. Those of us fortunate to ride with Hank know cycling brought him tremendous joy, even on the long, long hills, probably because he knew that what goes up must come down, or at least go flat. One day out on Suva Road, we were chatting about getting fitter and healthier. That's kind of my thing, right? Health and PE. About bicycling, and he just looked at me and he said, "I don't ride for the health benefits. I ride because it's fun." And that was exactly how that was him. Every ride had something funny. And each of us saw a different Hank, be it sensitive, although I never really saw that part. To be honest, sort of. Ornery, I got the ornery part, sometimes very serious when we had good conversations on the bike, and always something funny. Hank knew we all had special needs, really, and he was adept at tailoring his rides to those with whom he rode. Just a couple of weeks ago, he was riding with Kara and I for a short 40-miler. And for a bit of time, this was all safe, but for a bit of time, because we were out in the boonies, he'd ride with me, and we'd chat along. And then he'd fall back, and he'd ride with Kara, and they would sign. And then he'd come up, and he'd ride with me, and we'd chat. And that went on for much of the ride. He made each of us feel special, even if that meant waiting to ride, because that's what we needed. He was patient, oh, so patient. One time, and he said, we were, you know, waiting to ride, and we were in the garage, and as usual, it was a little later than I had anticipated, and he said, "I've learned that leaving time with Linda and Kara and you is always later than expected." And he would just kind of hang out in his man cave and do his little bike stuff, and he was very happy to just wait. I'm not that patient. Hank was always looking for that epic ride, and truth be told, he likely had several. Riding Alpe d'Huez, part of the Tour de France in the French Alps with Linda last summer, had to be the epic of epic rides. But based on his stories, I'm pretty confident that Hank and Linda had several epic rides on singles and on the tandem. And I think mostly they were epic because they rode together. And the stories he shared about riding with Lisa and Alex, that was true love, shared by parent and child, just true love. So, Linda, thanks for sharing. Because, you know, the time that he spent with us on rides, he wasn't at home cooking for you. Hank and I had a few not epic rides. Pouring rain, climbing Mount St. Helens, rain and sleet on McKenzie Pass. It was 40 degrees up there, and we were hiding in the little outhouse. We took pictures with our phones with each other, you know, and he would say, "You know, my wife's going to really wonder why I have a picture of you in the outhouse." Oh, well. Rain at Peach of the Century. And I always thought it was Hank bringing on all the rain until I realized that I, too, was a common element. But you knew it was epic when Hank exclaimed multiple times, "That was epic!" And he did with such joy. But he didn't really need to yell it, right? He didn't even need to say anything at all, for the sheer joy on his face said it all. And I will always carry in my heart Hank the scholar, Hank the teacher, Hank the colleague, because, you know, we also work together here, Hank the loving father, Hank the smitten and doting husband, even when he pretended not to be. But it's those moments he was in the moment, and Jerry Brazza, you would be so proud. That childlike wonder at the surrounding beauty as we rode through snow tunnels on the Kinsey Pass. Big snow tunnels, 30 feet on one side, 20 feet on the other, and then we went up a week or two later, Linda and Kathy and I, and that was epic even in the fog. That's what will sustain my every pedal stroke. Every single one, even this week. You know, Hank's right here. Not physically, but he's with me. And on the long climbs that I happen to take, I will always hear his incessant groaning from behind. I'd be riding up ahead and I'd just hear, oh!
Wonderful.
And Hank really had a lot of cyclist friends. I know a lot of you have probably biked with him in this room. But there were a few people that he biked with very often. Gay being one of them, the famous Gay, you would always know her name if you knew him. She loves hills, and she was so fast on those hills. And Hank and I would just be following behind her, and Hank would give me this look like, oh, like she mentioned. And I totally got it. I totally got it going up those hills. And then there's Mark over here. And he would ride periodically, but Hank always admired Mark because he was so fast. Whether or not he biked often, he was so fast. And Hank really looked up to him for that. And then there was Michael. I don't know how to say her last name. And so he did Seattle to Portland, that event, 200 miles in one day. And I know that Hank had been practicing and training with the goal to be able to finish that Seattle to Portland event in one day like Michael. And then there's me. I'm the deaf one. Everybody would always ask me and wonder, how did we have such a good relationship? How do we communicate? I can't speak. I can't hear. He signed all right. And they would always wonder how we would communicate, especially on a bike. And we had biked together probably a good 3,000 miles, maybe 3,500 miles, maybe 2,500. And so we made it work. We made it work. We would usually go about 15 miles per hour, pretty slow for our standards, so that we could talk back and forth. The relationship I had with him was more childlike. We talked like we were school-age friends, boys and girls. We would count how many blue herons we could see. We would see who could get them the fastest. Deaf people tend to have good vision, and so we can see things before hearing people most times. And so I would usually beat him, but the last time we played together, he went up to me. So I'll never forget that. And anytime we'd pass any animals in the field, we'd stop and say hello, every single animal that we passed. I'm telling you, it was like we were kids. There were two special goats that we would often frequent over on Stapleton Road, and many of you know this story. And they would always sit up on their little house, and he would always say, "That's my lunch, that's my dinner." So now they're affectionately named Lunch and Dinner. Linda, I'm sure you know this story. Yes, all of you know this story. So he would always say, "Look, there's lunch and dinner." And if they weren't there, he would say, "Did I eat them today? I can't remember." So you can imagine our laughter. I just became so used to getting up every morning and having a text from him because he woke up so early. And I would always have a text waiting, asking what my schedule was for the day, seeing if we could get a ride in. He would always bike over to my house and pull up into my driveway, where my door would be open and my kids would be waiting to wave to Uncle Hank. We're gonna miss that. I was so fortunate to have him. He gave me the opportunity to be part of his life. Now, the group of us who biked with him at one time aren't going to stop. We're going to keep biking because we know that he is watching down and that he's probably up there in heaven convincing Jesus at this time to get on a bike. You guys saw the article from Salem Bike Club. He usually did 2,000 miles, and that was his goal. But last year he did 3,000 miles, and he was so excited because that was one of his dreams. So I'm curious, who here, if anybody here has biked with him, can you please stand just to get an idea?
So I just want to close with a reading, but a twist on a reading of it's the Irish blessing. So this is a blessing to an Italian cyclist. May the road rise up to meet you, but only slightly, because we know how much you hated hills, and with a good run out, because gravity was always your strong suit. May the wind always be at your back, so you can feel strong and fast, even when your legs are bricks. May the sun shine warm up on your face, but not too warm, because you got a bit cranky in the heat. May the rains fall soft upon your fields, but only at night, so the roads are dry by morning. And until we meet again, my friend, may you only ride the best Chinelli with a sumo wrestler horn and butterfly streamers and top-of-the-line Campy components. And may God hold you in the palm of his hand. Right on, my friend.
In 2005, Jerry Barraza and Tuan Nguyen traveled to northern Vietnam and were struck by the poverty and difficult conditions under which many rural people were living. Upon returning home to Oregon, they started a nonprofit organization called the Forgotten People Foundation, to work in advocacy and support of these individuals. In 2007, Jerry asked if I would become the executive director, and I quickly recruited my friend Hank Bersani to join me. Hank and I have traveled to Hanoi twice in the last 3 years, supporting our home for abandoned and disabled children in Hoang La Village, supporting schools, children, and teachers in rural Bac Giang province, and initiated work in leprosy advocacy at the Qua Com Leprosy Village outside of Bac Ninh City. Hank and I were planning a third trip to Hanoi in December with a group of students from Central High School. We'll still go, but it won't be nearly as much fun. I'd like to share just a couple observations from our trips to Vietnam that I feel illustrate Hank's character. First, Hank was freakishly warm. And I don't mean warmth of spirit or anything like that. I mean, he was hot. And sweaty. During our last trip, Southeast Asia was gripped in what the newspapers were calling a bitter cold spell. Hank never once put on anything other than a short-sleeved t-shirt, and our Vietnamese friends referred to him on several occasions as the white bear. Second, Hank liked to eat. Now, he and I share this passion, but we'd be walking the streets of Hanoi trying to both carry on a conversation and also avoid the many speeding scooters honking rudely at the two large guys hogging the shoulder. More than once, I'd turn to tell him something, only to find that he'd stopped at a street-side food vendor, mouth-watering over some new and bizarre discovery that he'd made. He told me one time his culinary goal was to have one bite of everything, which I thought was quite aggressive, but still a fascinating goal. Third, Hank was genuinely interested in people. I found myself on many occasions involved in conversations with, for example, a group of deaf Vietnamese people sitting around a fire in a barrel in a bad part of Hanoi at midnight. A guy with no legs who had made his own hand pedal cart outside of Ho Chi Minh's mausoleum, and a severely Agent Orange afflicted husband and wife team of silk tailors in a small village on the way to Halong Bay. In each instance, Hank's enthusiasm to learn about others provided fascinating windows of opportunity for our work, and I learned much from his example. Finally, Hank was a great jungle gym. It was not uncommon for us to visit a small community, school, or playground, and Hank would leave me to deal with the foundation business while he would go play with children. I remember one instance in particular where the white bear would pretend to be asleep and 24-year-old preschoolers would creep up toward him only for him to awaken with a roar, much to the screams of delight of these children. It was wonderful. I could still picture him dripping with sweat with four kids hanging off him and an enormous smile saying, "Oh, Mark, let's just stay for a few more minutes." I can honestly say that I don't know anybody who lived life more fully or with more joy than Hank. If you're interested in the work of the Forgotten People Foundation, you can Google our organization or visit the table, the display in the back of the room. All the pictures back there were taken by Hank on our travels. I've challenged folks to donate $1 for each year of Hank's life to support the work and his legacy through children and adults with disabilities in rural Vietnam. I hope you'll join me in remembering him in this way.
People have always told me things like, "You're one of a kind," or "You're impossible to understand," until they meet my dad. I'm a young man with little idea where I'm going in life. Actually, that's not quite as true as it was a few days ago. But I've often felt that I've spent more time thinking than doing, and I still have much to accomplish. In my dad, I saw a version of myself who was complete. Or, maybe more accurately, in myself, I see an incomplete picture of my dad. If we're all puzzles, I have my edges connected and a few random chunks here and there, but even from a distance, it's tough to see what the picture will be. When I looked at my dad's puzzle, even though it too was far from complete, I could see the picture clearly. The pieces that were missing didn't seem to matter because they didn't detract from the whole. This was not something easily missed by those who knew him. A word I hear thrown around a lot at a time like this is happy. And although he never articulated it so, I think that my dad held this word to a higher expectation than did the average person. The Greeks called it eudaimonia, and it doesn't just mean having a good day. It means finding oneself in such an arena that one is able to push oneself closer and closer to the truth, to the absolute, and to the divine. I saw this in my father every day. He brought a higher truth to everyone around him, but no one more so than his family. I'm perfectly comfortable saying that I want him here again for my own selfish reasons. I wasn't finished learning from the only true sage I've ever known. And while I, as did he, shy away from frivolities when it comes to language, I really don't think I'm dressing this up too much. In fact, I may be downplaying it. Imagine a time when something amazing happened to you and you had to downplay it to your friends to act like it really wasn't so great in order to not hurt their feelings. That's how I've always felt about my dad. "Yeah, he's great," I'd say out loud to his friends, when inside I'm rejoicing that he was able to reveal the world to me in the way that he did. The words I'm using today are not in place simply because he died, but because I have always felt them and just thought it would be rude to say out loud, like an eagle boasting to an ostrich the miracle of flight. When I was younger, of course, I hated my father. He seemed so unfair. Why do I have to do chores when my friends don't? How am I supposed to explain this to my friends? "Well," he said, "just tell them that you have the meanest daddy on the block, and there's nothing you can do about it, so you can't go out and play." I never understood why he thought this was a solution. But now I see its brilliance. I thank everything I can think of that he stayed alive long enough for me to be able to find the truths that he buried so deep into tough love. I feel blessed to have had the time with him that I did. Over the past few years, my parents and I became close and honest for the first time as adults. For a while, I was under the impression that I was a disappointment to them. My mother, of course, had done more than could have ever been expected, but this not being her remembrance ceremony, I'll save those stories for another time. When my father became aware that I didn't understand that he was proud of me or loved me, he began to go out of his way to spoon-feed it to me, which I needed. Yet, when his predictions about dangerous behavior became true, there was never any "I told you so," because he knew that I knew, even though I would never admit it. He would only poke and prod at you in a way that was meant to shift your way of thinking. He wasn't afraid to make you hate him, because he had a better view of the big picture. Going back to what I said before about being a mean daddy, he was eager to play the role of the villain if he thought it would help someone else shift their point of view just a little bit closer to the truth. While I was writing this, I saw a Zyrtec commercial that said, if your kid can recognize your sneeze in a crowd, then you probably have allergies. Well, anyone who's ever heard my dad sneeze can recognize his sneeze from 200 yards. But he didn't have allergies. His was simply the sneeze of a man who knew the pull he had. When I was a young kid, being an altar server at church, he would give a meaningful cough to keep me in line if I ever fidgeted during Mass. To everyone else, it was just a guy clearing his throat. But to us, it was our secret language that meant more at that moment than any length of discussion about do this or don't do that. He taught me how to tolerate those with whom we disagree and how to show them that my life and my will were what came first, and that if someone thinks ill of us, we should make it be their problem and not ours. If someone says to you, why do you do things that way? You're completely wrong. An acceptable answer is, because it pisses you off. This was an all right way to settle things, because one's own motivation supersedes the expectations of those around us. Among the people who can testify to this are my mother, my sister, his parents, and his sister, and the countless thousands around the world, not the least of which are the group of nuns in Saigon who run the orphanages of disabled children you've been hearing about, a group to whom he was planning his third trip. One thing that became mine at the time of his death was his guitar. Sitting next to it when I found it was the sheet music for the song, Ain't No Grave Can Hold My Body Down. I never knew what that meant until his passing. I was sad to think that this is what it took for me to understand, but I choose to focus on the fact that he continues to teach me, even after his death. His death is one that I admire. I have never been frightened of being dead, but the act of dying scares me. He was lucky enough to do it with all the utmost elegance and ease, and while I will miss him for the rest of my life, I take comfort in the fact that he died the way I want to. Quickly, doing what he loved, leaving behind many to mourn him. He always told me that people such as himself among his community were known as TABS, T-A-B, meaning temporarily able-bodied. The fact that he wanted me to understand this shows that he, better than I, understood the brevity of youth and life. He, along with his adoring wife, my mother, never took for granted their blessings, and so with my father gone, I'm left with no regrets that he didn't know how I felt. For this, I consider myself extraordinarily lucky. It has become my responsibility to follow this lifestyle and to appreciate every moment with the ones I love. So please, go home today, and even if it sounds trite, tell the ones you love the way you feel, because in my case, it has made all the difference. Thank you.
Before he died, my dad got right with God. He asked forgiveness for his wrongdoings at church just the night before. Not enough time had passed to start in again on mucking up the clean slate, even for the most doggedly stubborn person, which he was. Reconciliation, the forgiveness of sins, is an important part of the Catholic faith. Many people try, but not everyone is able to get the timing down so well before they die. My dad always was the most prompt member of our family. So much so that he used an acronym for that singular time of the family schedule when we absolutely had to leave the house and get in the car for wherever we were going if we were going to be on time. He called it ass in seat. A-I-S. Thanks for all the eloquent gems, Dad. Just last year, my dad bought me a new bike. Fanciest birthday present I ever got. He liked doing stuff like that for me, even though he knew that, like him, I prefer the simple things in life. But he was a generous soul, and he liked encouraging my brother and me in our interests. He'd give me a bottle of extra virgin olive oil every year at Christmas. It was a little joke between the two of us after a crack I'd made once about not being able to live without it. I'd had a running Christmas tradition with him, too, when I was very young. Dad's habit of leaving his umbrellas on the metro turned into a hilarious joke I could play when every year, whether he needed it or not, an umbrella-shaped present was under the tree for him from my mom and me. My favorite part was watching him prod, squeeze, and shake the wrapped gift in feigned confusion over what it could possibly be, until I couldn't help myself and would blurt out, "It's another umbrella!" His myriad accomplishments have been partially listed here today. I'm so proud of my dad for all these and so many more things he did. The world has lost a great man. But for our family, it will be the everyday routines where we miss him most. We lost the person who took the trash cans out to the curb every week, an important spot at the dinner table. The person who knew, the one person who knew what each of the three remotes actually do. The reason we had to use the remotes to rewind because we didn't hear part of the movie because he was talking over it to predict the ending. Someone who always made sure we knew we were loved. We lost our only dad, only brother, only son, and only husband. It's not fair. It doesn't make any sense. We weren't prepared for this. None of us know how life is supposed to go without him. So I need for all of us to stick together in the trying. Students and colleagues, keep on remembering him. Continue his work. Push yourself a little farther. Go a little deeper. Bicyclists, keep riding in his honor. Keep letting yourself love it. And carry on his utmost priority of safety at all times. Friends and neighbors, help us figure out how to maintain our old traditions and when to make new ones. Help us keep celebrating his life, telling his stories, laughing at his jokes. Help us recognize the ways he's still with us. The strength of our connections and memories will keep us going. Thank you for your help.
Anybody who knows Hank knows that there are lists everywhere. So I had to bring one of Hank's lists. Little scribbled notes that if you could read them, you would know a lot about what was going on in his mind, which sometimes I'm sure was a very scary place because there was so much going on all the time. But his most recent list that seemed to be right inside his office door, his home office door, was thanks and follow-up. Ron DeVolder, is Ron here? Ron? Thanks from Hank. Apparently was going to thank you for something, so we'll talk about what that was. Katie Mack. Katie may or may not be here today, but she was Thursday. Thanks, Katie. The Rizzos, cousins, a couple other people. James Whitehouse, maybe he's here. And at Woo, he's going to update his Vita. He's going to do some more research. He's going to work on the medical class and something else that's not readable. So, I mean, this was Hank. Hank lived life fully, like Mark said, and I thought, you know, maybe I'd talk to you about his parenting, but I don't think I could do anything more. You've seen his parenting here today, and he couldn't be prouder, and neither could I. But, you know, so let me talk for a minute about marriage. He was my only husband. I was his only wife. And I was married to him for 33 years. And we dated for a couple of years before that. I met Hank at a professional workshop in July of 1976 in Omaha, Nebraska. So even way back then, he was traveling around. And he talked to me about, I was living in Saskatchewan at the time, working for the Canadian Association, Saskatchewan Association for the Mentally Retarded, as it was called then, and running a citizen advocacy program. And I knew Dr. Wolf Wolfensberger, who was then at Syracuse University, where Hank was working. And so as Hank and I talked during the 6 days of this workshop in Omaha, he started telling me more and more about Syracuse and what a nice place it was and how wasn't it time to go back to graduate school. And, you know, our friend Dr. Bersani would be happy to help me get into the grad school. And Anyway, that happened. He actually personally delivered my application to the dean of the School of Graduate School of Education at Syracuse, and before I knew it, I was in January of 77. Got my master's in special ed those 2 years, and this is not about me, but just to kind of tell you how, you know how Hank works. So what did I learn from Hank? Well, the first thing was how not to make a bed. Because I was raised in Canada with a military father, ex-military, and a banker who was very orderly, and things were, I just inherited that. I don't know if it was genetic or trained, but I always had a tidy bedroom and made my bed. And when I met Hank, or at least after we were married, that was not so much his style, some of you may know. So we had a little compromising to do, but you know, I learned from him, it really doesn't matter if the bed gets made. But what matters is to rock the children, to read the story, to reach out beyond your family, and to share your life and your gifts with others. I learned from Hank how to laugh more often. Maybe the other part of my Canadian upbringing was, we have some good Canadian comedians, but was that we're a little serious, we're nice, and we're gentle, and we're polite, and we're composed. And, you know, when Dr. Wolfensberger did find out we were going to get married, he was just, shook his head in disbelief. He said, it can't be. Bersani? Linda Brown? It's impossible. But, you know, like a magnet, we came together. He was the pepper and I was the salt, and we did compliment each other. So I learned to laugh more and more often from Hank. I learned how to reach high. I learned how to strive for seemingly unattainable goals. He encouraged me always. He appreciated that I wanted to raise our children in the most intentional way that I could and we could, and he wanted me to do that. And he, part of his working hard and traveling was to allow me to be able to be home in the early years that I wanted to be with the children. But when I was ready to get back into my career and my profession, he couldn't do enough to support and provide what I needed for that to happen. And I will always appreciate that. I went back to school when our son Alex went to college, and I got my administrative credential and work in Albany School District now as an administrator. But, you know, when I said to him, I don't think I can do that, I don't know, that seems like an awful lot. He said, well, just go take the class. Just go take the first class, the intro, and you'll find out. And I took the first class, and I went, wow, that's very interesting. I may have some inclination there. Maybe there is something. And he said, well, just enroll in the program, and, you know, you go through the program. You enjoy the studies. You don't have to become an administrator. Just go through the program. I went through the program, and I liked it more and more. And before I knew it, of course, I was an administrator. But without Hank, I would not have done that. So he encouraged women. He encouraged his own wife. He encouraged his daughter. He was certainly guided by his mother, who has already been mentioned, first woman judge in Onondaga County, New York. And she, too, always believed in women and all people being able to move to their level of interest and ability without limits. I learned how to live with gusto from Hank. When I met him, I thought spaghetti came in a can. It was Chef Boyardee. Hank, of course, taught me otherwise, and the many wonderful meals we had that we always wanted to share with others may have been, sometimes there was spaghetti sauce on the tablecloth, and there were 14 pots to clean in the kitchen, but boy, did we have fun, both the cooking and the sharing of the wonderful food. He made a meal a celebration, and he made music. Even though he wasn't all that good at it, he never gave up at things. He would go back to the guitar and keep working on learning new chords and playing when he could. But mostly I learned how to live with integrity. I had some background because I have a wonderful family, but what Hank did was he taught us, I think, to live with integrity even at the great risk of causing discord at times. So maybe not to be afraid. Some of the things that Alex shared already, of what the response might be if there's something that he felt needed to be said. I learned from that. And I learned how to persevere, which is part of our ability to be here with you today, I believe, is that he would have wanted this. He would have wanted, he never gave up on a vision of hope, of peace, and of social action. And we want to carry forward that that example. And finally, he taught me how to be accountable and how to hold others to accountability. And in this, for Hank, lies our human dignity. My mother-in-law and sister-in-law are here today and have chosen not to share with you today, knowing this was the professional community, but Mary Beth, his sister, spoke at the funeral the other day, and I loved one of her lines. They're just the two in the family, and she's had a running joke with him for many years that Mom always liked him better. And when she delivered the line at the funeral and said, "Well, it's really true that Mom always liked you better, but now I know why," because she learned a lot of things about him that maybe she didn't know. And the same with his wonderful mother. And his dad is definitely here with us in spirit, and we can't wait to share with him how many of you were here to help honor Hank's life. And so I want to end with how Hank lived life fully in his gratitude. Hank appreciated his friends, never taking them for granted. He would be so honored and humbled to see the outpouring of grief, the testimonials to his life, the beautiful words and feelings that have been expressed by so many about the impact he made on their lives, on your lives. In fact, he would be dumbfounded. He would think all of this is over the top. But when I thought about that, I thought, you know, Hank was an over the top kind of guy. And bless all of you who knew that. And but most of all, I know he'd want to say thank you. He'd want to thank you for the support you gave to him in his lifetime, to thank you for your works that guided and inspired him. So many of you here guided and inspired him. And he'd want to thank you for carrying forward anything positive that you may have learned from him. And he'd want to thank you most personally for your physical and spiritual presence and support to me and all of his family. You have indeed honored his memory. Thanks especially to his colleagues and friends of this extraordinary community that is Western Oregon University. You have shown extravagant generosity. You have shown it to him in putting up with some of his stuff, I'm sure, at times, and certainly to his family this week in so many small and large ways, culminating with this wonderful memorial to one of your own. Western was the perfect professional home for him. Mimi, you are so right. Where he was challenged and supported to grow to be a better professor, a mentor, a friend, and indeed a better person. Thanks to President Weiss and Meg, to Provost Neely, to Dean Hilda Rosella, and past President John Minahan, who is, not sure he's here, but he's been with us. Is he here today, Patty? Yeah, well, he was here with us throughout the week anyway, and gave me the most wonderful, loving hug that I will never forget, that I felt embraced somehow symbolically, the university, embracing our family. I know it wasn't always easy, and to his colleagues, to many special people here, too many of you to list by name, but I know who you all are, and so many of you are here. I know that you cared, and thank you to his students, past and present. Those testimonials from you three were just extraordinary. You gave his life meaning, and you carry on his work. So thank you, and I love you all, and I know that you will find a way to express other ways, if you wish to continuing the scholarship that Hank loved and honored here at Western Oregon University, so that we may carry on his work. It's not about Hank Bersani, the person. It's about Hank Bersani and hopefully what he taught us and what he gave us of those really lasting values. So please know that we grieve him for him, of course, very personally, but we are so very supported by you walking with us and for you helping to carry on the important values that Hank tried to live. And I just a quick personal thank you from me. I have my only three brothers here, my only three siblings who came from all over this country and Canada. Gordon, would you stand up, from Montreal, Canada? And Gary from Atlanta, Georgia, and his wife Linda, stand up and turn around. And my brother Alan D. Brown from Victoria, British Columbia, turn around and just say hi to everybody. A final word is that there are many here that I've worked with in my professional work, and I want to thank them as well. Human Services Research Institute, Salem Kaiser Student Services Friends, and Greater Albany Public School School District represented by our superintendent, our high school principal. I see friendly, beautiful faces out there. I can't wait to talk to you all afterward. And so I know we'll be chatting more informally over lemonade and cookies very soon. So thank you all for being here and for everything you mean to Hank and to me.
Once in a